day reaching in to early evening. The room was cool, cooler inside than out. As I waited, I sat close to a small fire, banked in the pale hearth. Every so often, the girl added wood and the scent of magnolia tree and pine cone contentedly. The door from the room to the kitchen was not quite open, not quite closed. I could see a well-scarred table, a small stove, white porcelain bowls of various sizes. I could hear the girl move about her chores. Before long, she returned with a tray, a steaming glass of chocolate, a plate of apricots, and in one of the white bowls, roast salt almonds of delicious and subtle taste, like marzipan, like Christmas. Was it only this morning I had called with my bookseller, a learned, reliable man, and he showed me with some excitement the book recently come to his disposal, Mirandola's Illustrio Hortan Flores. The condition was good, though well handled, the spine delicately and lightly toed in gilt, was chipped but not broken. There were one or two scores in the calfskin binding. The softness surprised me. Then the bell above the shop door sounded, and we were joined by our friend and scholar, Armilo Gomez. He registered small surprise at the discovery. "Allow me," he said, turning to the ownership inscription at the foot of the title page. Yes, it belonged first to her grandfather. Then, as you see, she took it for herself. It's typical of her library, or I should say, what her library was. Look, her signature. Property of Joanna de la Cruz, the worst. Showing no further interest, he and our bookseller drew towards the shelf of special collections. I returned to the book, turned the pages, turned to the back, and discovered an inner pocket made of cloth. Inside this, a folded manuscript, the hand of the front page inscription. Carefully unfolding the pages, I read Primero, Sveno, and saw a long poem forming neat columns. I heard my bookseller call to me. I returned the pages to the inner pocket. "How much?" I asked, and raised my eyebrows at his response. "But look," I said, occasionally underlining handwritten text throughout the margin. He smiled, still under intrigue with Gomez, who had now in his hand the familiar magnifying glass. Such preoccupation was to my favour as we came to a price on which we both agreed. And then the book, now in my possession, I experienced an urgent, almost frightening instinct to be gone from my friends, and more especially from the bookshop. With unusual haste, I bid each a farewell and entered in to the still cool and mellow light of the morning. The idea came to me immediately, the sun not yet high in the heavens. My journey passed unbeknownst to me and with extraordinary swiftness. Raised by the novelty of my discovery and by the outcome I anticipated, my purpose became the equal of a favourite travelling companion. My attitude was light, my step positively brisk. Neither was finding San Geronimo a burden. Once arrived at the city, the clean sound of the bell's call to prayers of the nuns indicated my final direction. fading, I moved toward a loose stone pathway, risen without being sharp, and soon led by a hand known, not known, the expanse of the austere and perfectly rectangular two-story cloister was before me. The iron gates of the arched entrance opened wide to reveal an inner city being in stark contrast with the sparse building that enclosed it. The courtyard moved from a free and open geometrical truth into a random, spiraling, and distinctly complicated labyrinth. A constructed architecture formed from the many small and varying buildings and apartments, each extending from the wall of its other. From a journey that passed peacefully and uneventfully, I faced now the impulse of my intention, of mindlessness, and experienced also my first encounter with a seizing vertigo.